This is Pace Per Mile. For more on the latest news, reviews, check out pacepermile.com. Like us on Facebook and join in the conversation on Twitter. With host Chris Nicholas, this is Pace Per Mile.
Welcome to Pace Per Mile. I'm Chris Nicholas. An exciting interview today. Two individuals that you probably will want to listen to this over and over again, because the information that we're going to talk about here in the next few minutes is probably something that maybe you haven't known about or learned about, and that is how to train and race with an impaired athlete. Welcome to the show, Carolyn Gaynor.
Hi, thank you.
And Rachel Weeks.
Hi, thank you very much.
And for me, I'll tell the both of you that I'm probably going to play a little bit dumb today, because this is very new for me as well. I've just had a chance to read a little bit about it, but you both have experienced it together. So you've actually trained and raced together, and now you're going to do it again this weekend with Ironman Texas. I think for the audience over the next few minutes, I think they're going to be kind of completely impressed by your story. Carolyn, you are the person that's going to be taking Rachel through the event this weekend with Ironman Texas. But before we even talk about that, let's go back to last year, how the two of you have met, and then how are you actually bringing an athlete from the start to the finish of a race?
Well, to go back to how we met, you know, I've been guiding visually impaired athletes in triathlon since 2008, and it really changed my life being able to do races like that. So I sort of, you know, keep an eye out for people who might be interested in doing a race, just because, you know, I love guiding. So I guess last year Rachel had posted a question on Twitter, and I started talking to her, you know, via Twitter, and we ended up coordinating and doing the Chicago Triathlon together. We never met until the day before, or 2 days before the race.
And with you, Rachel, did you decide that you were just going to start getting into races and want to compete? When did that start to develop?
I had been introduced to the Ironman race back in 2006, and I wanted to do it. But at that point in time, I had bought into the story that someone who was visually impaired and hearing impaired couldn't do it. And when I found Carolyn on Twitter, I had been kind of messing with it a little bit with my sister. We've been learning how to guide via running races. And when I saw how much Carolyn had been doing with visually impaired athletes, I was just blown away. And so once I met her and realized I could go to some of these bigger races and really make Ironman true, that's really what got the momentum going.
And Rachel, you are both visually impaired and hearing impaired. Back to the early days of your life, right? It was hearing impaired since the age of 3, and then what, college, you started to lose your sight?
Yes. When I was diagnosed at 3, it was just nerve damage. We don't know why. And I, you know, moved through life as a hearing impaired individual. I wear hearing aids in both ears. And when I reached into my university days, noticed some issues with my peripheral and night vision and having some trouble driving. And we went to get it checked up. And that's when I was told I'd had Usher's syndrome type 2, which there are other folks around the world that have it as well. It's pretty rare. It's genetic. And a pretty big bomb to be dropped on.
Carolyn, you probably jumped at the idea when Rachel reached out to you.
I think I might have actually reached out to her, because, you know, especially when I meet somebody like Rachel, who is just incredibly positive and a hugely, you know, influential person in terms of encouraging other people to get active and to just do good things with their lives. I mean, to me, it's an honor to race with her, so I was just excited to do it. I think I was like, come do the Chicago Triathlon, come do the New York Triathlon. I don't know if she had a choice, really.
True.
Now, let's go back to Chicago last year. What does it take? Because one of you is in New York. That's Carolyn, you're in New York. Rachel, you're in South Carolina. So it's not like the two of you are out every single weekend or a couple of times a week or a month training together. How does that work?
You know, that's why I feel so fortunate to have guided so many women. It's because I do feel confident riding a tandem bike, which I think is the hardest part for many people. But, you know, so Rachel put her trust in me. That was really all that happened. The Chicago Triathlon is, you know, close to my heart, because I've done it every year for the past. This will be my 13th year coming up. So she did my 12th Chicago Tri with me. So I know that course well. But she came and she trusted that I could, you know, be an effective guide. And we ended up, it was better than that. We just had an amazing time.
Did you have to do a lot of training then, Rachel, on your own? How does your training schedule look during the week or the month?
For me, it's, you know, every day is an adventure. Sometimes I can find a captain for my tandem. Sometimes I can find a guide. And also getting transportation to go do open water swims or even get in the pool, it's quite an adventure. So I had to really take off that perfect training hat and really just get the best I could out of what I can and do my best.
And there are groups and organizations that you can reach out to. How does that part of that equation work?
I think for me, I just get resourceful. I'll reach out to the local triathlon clubs. There's Facebook groups. Different organizations that I can name off. There's like 10 of them I can think of offhand. But just, you know, being proactive for yourself, getting resourceful. Hey, I'm a visually impaired athlete. I really want to get active. Do you know anybody out there? And just by doing that, I've met some amazing people just like Carolyn, you know, that step up and go, oh my gosh, that sounds awesome. Let's do it.
And this can be done. I'm sure there are some listeners that are listening to the program right now that know somebody that is impaired, hearing impaired, visually impaired, and they probably have never thought that that athlete could make it from the start to the finish line, but you are proof that you can, and you can do it again and again. Were you nervous that first time? You must have been, you know, relying on Carolyn to get you through.
Funny, I think I have been dreaming this for so long that when I saw that door open, I was just so excited. And yeah, there was a part of me that's like, wow, things could really go wrong really quick. But for me, if I just put my focus in having fun and knowing that it's not just about getting the finish line, it's just I get to be side by side with these able-bodied athletes. I got the opportunity, and that's all that matters.
What about you, Carolyn? Were you nervous?
You know, I try not to be nervous because to me, one of my favorite, you know, one of the things I like the most about guiding is being able to be sort of, and I can't say that I'm always calm, but I do like to be sort of the calming, you know, voice in the group. So I try to just crack a lot of jokes, honestly. I have to talk down a lot of panic attacks, you know, I think that, because I think open water swimming is probably the most difficult part for any athlete, and especially if they're visually impaired, and it's not about your swimming ability, it has nothing to do with it. It has to do with jumping into a huge body of water with a whole bunch of different athletes. I mean, Ironman has, you know, 2,000 starters, a huge mass of bodies in the water, just, it seems like everyone's trying to drown each other, but they're not, they're all trying to go to the same place.
Yeah, and I'll just kind of go off of that a little bit. I was not expecting to be nervous in the water, and I ended up with a panic attack. And through Carolyn, what she just said she did for me, and I was able to move through and keep going and finish the race. So, yes, the nerves do come up, especially in the swims for a visually impaired athlete, but it's kind of cool when you have guys like that that step up and do that for you.
And Rachel, just for our audience, is there any sight at all, any blurriness? Is it just completely black what you see? What's the status of your vision?
Yeah, and I'm really glad you stated that because there's a wide variety of us out there competing. And for me, I have central vision. It is blurry. The light affects it greatly. So if I have direct sunlight on me, I sometimes can't see people. But if you see me in a different situation with the lighting a little bit better, it looks like I can see perfect. So I've had people kind of say, well, are you vision impaired enough to be able to do that? And it's a tricky business. And there are some people out there that are completely blind. There's some people that have functional vision, yet sometimes the functional vision can actually be harder to deal with in a race situation because you can rely on it or you may not be able to rely on it. So you don't really know, and it's kind of uncertain in some areas.
To run blindfolded, does it, like when you're in the water, would you have your eyes completely covered in the sense so that it's not affected or during that run or during the bike?
Yeah, I mean, like in the swim, I close my eyes because it's just harder to even try to rely on any vision. Yeah, I've seen people do the 5Ks and such, and it's pretty neat to see them do that. And in some ways, it can help. It just depends. And for me, with my hearing impairment, it wouldn't. That makes any sense.
Well, and it's two senses that you definitely would rely on. So take us through, Carolyn, from the start to the finish of a triathlon and what we'll expect here in the Ironman Texas this weekend. What will you do in preparation with Rachel? And then let's actually go through each discipline and figure out how that actually works. Do you let people around, you know, when you get into the transition area, is there a certain area? Talk a little bit about how that works from the start to the finish.
No problem. And that's also what I'm really glad you asked. So nowadays, I think people are becoming a little bit more aware of para-athletes. So usually there is a separate area in the transition for para-athletes because there's special equipment that's involved. So Rachel's bike is a tandem bicycle, so it's a whole lot longer than normal bikes. And we will get extra space to put stuff down because there are two of us. And amputees are people who are, you know, paraplegic. They need room for their hand bikes and their push rim chairs. So it's we really do need the extra space. So what she and I will do, the normal stuff leading up to an Ironman is making sure your bike's working, making sure you're checked in, making sure your nutrition is ready. You know, since I've done these distances before, you know, I'll tell Rachel what I know, but it's a personal thing for everybody. But so really when we get there for race morning, Ironman has been nice enough to let para-athletes start right behind the pros, so we get a 10-minute head start, which is definitely helpful. That being said, you know, so that's in the swim. So we start like everybody else does. We'll have different color swim caps, hopefully. That's how most races do it. You know, back when I started, guides didn't even need to sign waivers. So this is a huge step up because it's a frightening thing to think that you're doing a race and nobody even knows that you're in it. And that's how it was in 2008, or at least the ones I did. But now, thankfully, I'm officially registered. I do not pay for an entry. No, that is not why I guide. People have actually asked me that. But, you know, at least they know that I'm in the race. I even have a race number so people know where I am at all times, which is good.
Do you see that people will tend to move out of your way more often, or is there still that competitiveness? What's kind of the atmosphere during the actual race itself?
I would not say there's any competitiveness, but I would say that there's lack of awareness, and I don't fault anyone for it. It's swimming, you know, it's hard, but I do try and make sure nobody swims in between us because we're tied together, you know, so that can be rough. I used to be a water polo goalie, so sometimes I'll play goalie and start grabbing heads just because, like, I don't want someone getting tangled and potentially, you know, dragging one of us down. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's worst-case scenario. I doubt it would happen, but my job is to be a protector in the water as far as I can see it, so I, you know, because we're not going to beat everybody out of the water. Obviously, 10 minutes head start is not that much in the grand scheme of things. So, yeah, I really just have to hold my breath and wait for the age group men to show up and start battling.
Yeah. And you've already done it. I mean, Chicago, tell us a little bit about how you finished in that event. Did you do well?
We were rocking it. I kept a really good even pace, and we were, you know, shooting for a 4, I think. And we ended up placing 2nd in the para division. I was completely floored with that result. So very excited. It was awesome.
What is, from your viewpoint, Rachel, if you were asked the question, I'm going to ask it right now, actually, if there was one, there was one thing that you could tell Carolyn to always do for you during the race, what would it be?
That is a very good question. I think what I loved about what she did for me is, like, she'll read off some of the signs for me. I remember we were coming in off the bike to the run, and she's like, oh, that sign said, you know, X, Y, and Z, and it would make me laugh. And because some of those things I miss, and when you need that distraction, you don't necessarily get to see it. Or she'll tell me, oh, this spectator has this crazy tutu on or something. So I think just having her keep doing that, especially during the Ironman race, is just huge for me because I love having fun, and that connects with me and keeps me focused on doing just that during the race.
Carolyn, same question, though. What about you when it comes to Rachel?
I couldn't ask for anything more from Rachel. I mean, the reason I'm so excited to race with her is because I did have such an amazing time, you know, in Chicago with her. And I just know that she laughs as much as I do, so, like, or probably more even. So I'm just excited. And funny, because the signs really do make the Ironman go faster, and especially really inappropriate ones. So hopefully there will be a lot of that in Texas.
And the two of you came together via Twitter. I mean, that was really it. You read something that Rachel had posted, and you reached out to her. Is that right?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, that's what I remember, right, Rachel?
It was spot on.
Yeah, and I started reading about her, and I friended her on Facebook and all that.
And to be miles apart, but then show up on race day and know that you have a common goal. Tell us a little bit about this weekend now. You raced Chicago last year. Rachel, when was the decision made to attempt to do Ironman Texas?
Yeah, I mean, even before I did my first 5K, I was like, I'm going to do an Ironman. And I had, you know, played with Florida a little while, and it was just so crazy to get into that. So I backed up a little bit, and it wasn't until October after I had already signed up for my marathon, I was on path to do that, that I was just going to jump in and do it. And Texas was open. It was, you know, in the middle of the country. So I just dived in and decided and texted Carolyn, and we go from there.
In Texas is, I think it's a visually impaired friendly course.
Yes.
It's, tandems, the hardest thing about a tandem, I think, is riding hills. And I've done two hilly Ironman races on the tandem. And it's brutal. And so I think a number of blind athletes have successfully completed Ironman Texas. So I think, besides the fact that I hate the heat, I think it was really a good choice in terms of courses.
And with the tandem, you both are utilizing your strengths, right? You're both cycling together.
Oh, yeah.
So you're both training, obviously, for this event. It's not necessarily all on Carolyn's shoulders, then.
No.
Oh, no. No, not at all. Yeah. Well, that's, I think, what's great about having a female guide, because until 2010, when I did Ironman Lake Placid as a guide, I think all the other women who had been doing Ironman, there might have only been one. I don't want to say for sure, but they'd had, you know, male guides, and there's a huge difference when you've got a big, strong, you know, dude on the front of the tandem. So, I mean, for us, it's a partnership, and it is not easier to ride a tandem than it is to ride a solo bike. It's just not. And having a female, it really makes it, it's a joint effort for sure.
Yeah.
Not to say that a guy could just do it with no problem, but I think that now it's becoming, you know, I mean, paratriathlon, it's going to be in Rio in 2016, so this is a really important sport, and people are becoming more aware of it.
What about for you, Rachel, and Carolyn, certainly you can jump in on this, because I'm sure you have interacted with race directors and organizations out there. Is there still that brick wall, I guess it would be, for impaired athletes to compete in any race that they really want to?
I think there's not really a wall as so much they don't know. So when you go in and you may get like a negative response, you just have to kind of step back and say, okay, they just don't understand. So it's our job to really kind of explain the process sometimes. I know in Chicago we had to do some talking with a group up there, and they wanted to work, they just didn't know what to do. And once we helped them through the process, everything was fine. So it's not a wall as much as an education point for them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, that being said, there are some barriers. Like, for instance, Rachel can't qualify for Kona the way, I mean, there isn't a great qualification system for Kona for para-athletes, and I don't believe visually impaired athletes can qualify based on time. I think you can enter a lottery. So hopefully that's something that'll come in the future, but right now she couldn't qualify even if she, you know, had a blazing fast time, which is sad.
Is there work to be done in that area?
Yeah, I mean, we're coming a long way. I mean, the blackout glasses for USAT have been done away with, and now people can race without wearing blackout glasses. That was a huge victory for visually impaired athletes. So, yeah, I think the next step would be something like, you know, we get to use our time instead of being in a lottery. So that way we can, you know, we work hard just like everybody else does. And I completely agree with that.
Harder.
I think there's something... Yeah, I think it's coming a long way. There's still work to be done, as always, but yeah, it's looking good.
Just to give you a brief blackout goggles, the thing was that, you know, for a couple of years, visually impaired athletes were required to wear glasses that were blacked out to, quote, like, level the playing field, but they sort of put this in without research, without anything, and it prohibited certain people from racing, because if you had the amount of vision that Rachel does, you know, you're used to working with that amount of vision, and then suddenly you're being told that if you want to qualify for any high-level event, you have to be completely in the dark. I mean, it's virtually impossible to adapt to that. It's dangerous, and it's humiliating. So we're just really, really glad that that's not a rule anymore.
And if you had to say this is the next thing that they should do away with, it is the lottery style, is that what you're saying?
No, I'm just saying they should have a way for visually impaired athletes to qualify, whether it's a time standard or, you know, because there aren't enough visually impaired athletes doing Ironman to say, okay, you have to place here among all visually impaired athletes, because it's probably just one. But, you know, I don't know what the solution is, but I really hope that there will be a way besides the lottery for visually impaired athletes to go to Kona. I think, you know, they deserve the opportunity.
And Rachel, one day, will you do Kona?
Oh, yes. That is my next goal. Absolutely.
Well, we heard that the swim is obviously a bit scary. The bike is challenging, obviously, being on the tandem there. But out of the three disciplines, Rachel, what was the easiest for you?
What is easiest for me?
Or the most enjoyable?
Oh, it's hard. I love all three. I'm a triathlete. I think if I based on Chicago with me and Carolyn, I mean, just being on the bike, we placed first in that leg. And, I mean, we were just rocking it. There was some tight turn, and I was back there just, you know, trusting her. And I just have a lot of fun. And I got to tell you, looking forward to Ironman this Saturday, that's what I'm looking forward to, is the bike portion, very much.
Oh, yeah. I love the bike.
And other than talking about the signs that you're passing and the jokes and stuff, there's got to be some sort of signals that you give, you know, verbal signals or something, you know, do you tapping on shoulders, et cetera. What about that?
Well, I have to shout a lot because she's going to hear me over the wind. Well, and anybody does.
Right.
I try to focus the race on, you know, where we are in the race, what kind of effort we should be putting out, what the terrain is like. If there's a hill coming up, I'm going to talk about it. I'm going to do a terrible job estimating how long until the end of the hill. You know, I basically just try to not to be obnoxious about it, but I just try and narrate the course so that I tell her what I'm thinking and how I'm going to prepare physically and what I'm going to be doing so that our race is sort of in sync. Because she could be, and I tell her, conserve here, and this is what I do when I'm guiding anybody, but just, you don't, you know, it's all about learning how to race, and so I just communicate what I think, and then I ask for feedback, like, how is the cadence for you? What kind of effort do you want to do? Do you feel good right now? And that's the way to do it, I think.
I'm going to stay on that. She very much keeps it, this is my race. Because, you know, a lot of, if we were a team.
By her, she means Rachel's race.
Yeah, I mean, like, this is my race. Like, what is it you need? What do you want to do? What is your goal? And it's always kept on that. And sometimes I forget that because we are racing as a team. And then I realize, yeah, this is my race. And I don't say that to be, you know, egotistical or anything, but it's a good feeling. And she's really, really good about that. And as far as I know in the running portion, she's really good. She'll kind of pull my arm a little bit without, you know, like yanking me. It's very easy. It flows. It's not overdone, dramatic. And we just communicate with, you know, I don't know. We just kind of fell into a rhythm and it just kind of worked for us. It's hard to explain it. We just kind of roll with it, right?
Yeah, I think we definitely clicked in that respect. Yeah. If you had any, I'm sure you've seen people guiding before on the run, but yeah, it's everybody has their own preference in terms of how they want to be alerted to obstacles on the course, et cetera. And when it clicked, it's really nice and easy.
Well, I think there's a perception out there, at least I had that before we talked today, was that there is that perception that you're leading a visually impaired or hearing impaired or both athlete through the finish line or through the race. And we don't necessarily think about the competitive side. And Rachel wants a good time. She doesn't want to just finish it. She wants a great time. So I think by you explaining it that way, it helps at least me understand. I'm sure some of the listeners as well, that you're out there competing in a race.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah, and then she's relying on me to not let her down. And that's a scary feeling. I think this isn't just like, oh, I'm super confident. I've had races where, you know, I wasn't able to do what the athlete wanted me to do because I'm a human. I have my own, you know, we blow up. We're, I like to say that I'm equipment, but equipment malfunctions too. You know, you get a flat tire on the bike and you have to deal with it. So it's scary because I care so much about how she's going. You know, I want her to have the best race she can. But the thing, you know, Rachel's just incredibly kind and she understands all of that. And I don't plan to have a bad race, but it's always a something to think about. The guide is, they are equipment and they are supporting, but they're racing.
Right. Yeah, anytime I've had a guide, I've always kind of checked in. I'm like, how are you feeling? Because they are human too. And, you know, I just want to make sure, you know, that everything's good with them. They need anything as well. So I do check in with that. And it is my race. I've never felt led by any of my guides, and especially not with Carolyn. And it's my time.
What about when it comes to sponsors, though? Do you see that, Rachel, it's easy to, you know, look to sponsors for, because it has to be expensive, right? I mean, this tandem bike, you have to purchase it. The race is not providing it for you, right?
Right. Well, yeah, I mean, I was fortunate enough to, I got a challenge athlete GoFund grant. They put money toward my tandem. I was thrilled. It's, you know, pretty expensive for a tandem. So I got that, and I even got a step beyond that. Tri-Bike Transport is now transporting all visually impaired athlete bikes for free.
Wow.
So there are only a handful of us out there, and they just think it's
Thank
so
you.
Awesome that we'll step up. I know. They really stepped up. I got this random phone call from Brian and a Tri-Bike, and just completely floored because they thought it was true. They were so inspired by us that they wanted to help support us to get to more races. And, yeah, it can be barely easy.
And there, like you said, there is not a lot of athletes out there, but there's room for a lot of athletes. So it's
mm-hmm.
part of your
Yeah, I agree.
Role.
And I think, you know, the biggest thing for people who are listening that are visually impaired or even, you know, physically challenged is get out there with social media. Connect with people. I mean, I found Carolyn via Twitter. There are many groups out there and people blogging, and it is possible. And I used to be one of those people that I can't even believe this is happening, and now I'm doing it. And we all support each other, cheer each other on. There's guys out there, you know, building the guide base daily, and just kudos
yeah.
for them, because they're, I mean, it's just grown since I've even been involved. And for people to dedicate a whole race, I mean, Carolyn's doing Ironman for me. I mean, how awesome is that? I mean, she gets her time too, but wow, just so I can get across the finish line.
And Carolyn,
I want to build the guide base as much as possible, because for Rachel, as she said, she can't always find people to train with. If I did live near her, I still wouldn't be able to train with her every single day. And I think, you know, having more women become qualified, you know, and qualified doesn't mean there is no such thing as a qualification, but just having more women be comfortable riding a tandem and guiding on the swim and the run, that's what I want to do, because, you know, I'm guiding, I think, three other visually impaired women this summer, and I love it, and I want to keep doing it. But I do hope that we can get more women involved so that, you know, people don't have to feel like they need to fly in. Nobody feels like this. It just sounds really weird. I would love to keep guiding everybody, but I really want there to be enough opportunities for other women to step in and race, because it's so fun and so rewarding. And
it does sound obviously rewarding by the two of you talking about this. Ironman Texas this weekend. We're going to follow up with you next week and see how it went, if that's all right with the two of you. Expectations, Rachel?
I just want to kick the heat's butt. I really just don't want to allow the heat to get to me, and I want to have a great race. I mean, the course is just absolutely amazing. I really don't have a time. Like I said, this is my fourth triathlon, so I just want to finish. I want to wear my Ironman jacket. I want to, you know, celebrate and hear you know, them say that, and that's pretty much my expectation.
People want to track us. They can follow, you know, Rachel. Her number is 102. I have my own number, but I'll be with her, so.
Yeah, that would be great. We'll put that up on our Facebook and Twitter as well.
Yeah.
And Carolyn, as you mentioned a few moments ago, there's other athletes that you're training. So those that are out there that are thinking about this, that they want to get in and they want to be, you know, they want to help an athlete through a running race or a triathlon or an Ironman or any other event, what's their first step?
Well, so Achilles International is a really great organization that helps get, you know, guides involved. They work with all different types of para athletes. As I mentioned, I work with Team Red, White, and Blue, and this is actually an organization that's committed to connecting veterans with civilians and their community through physical and social interaction. And this is a nationwide group, but the people that I've been working with through Team Red, White, and Blue are just, like, so willing and able to help that, you know, they've stepped in and guided a number of people at this point just because they're so eager to help. So I encourage anyone who wants to join Red, White, and Blue to visit our website, and you'll be connected to me if you sign up as a triathlete, and feel free to ask any questions you want.
Excellent. And we're going to do a feature on Team Red, White, and Blue in the future here as well. It's a great organization, great group of athletes. But today, I'll tell you, it's about the two of you. You have shown that it is possible that you're going to continue to race together. And I'm sure after the Ironman Texas this weekend, the question will be asked, what's the next race? I hope there is going to be a next race. And if Rachel, have you kind of thought a little bit about that? Or is it just right here and now for Texas?
Oh, no, I already have a race schedule. I'll be traveling to Wisconsin next to do a 135-mile bike ride for my team Triumph, and I think team RWB as well. They're coordinating together, and so that's my next big race. Looking forward to it. It'll be hot and hilly and long, but I'm ready. I'm looking forward to it.
Carolyn, what about you? What's on your race schedule in the future?
Well, Well, I'm guiding one of my close friends, Tina Ament, in at Rev 3 Williamsburg, and then I'm guiding another wonderful woman, Leona Emberson, in the New York City Triathlon, and I'm guiding another woman, Amy Dixon, in her first triathlon ever on June 9th, the triathlon in New York. That takes me through mid-July.
That's great. Well, I commend the two of you for not only connecting, Carolyn, for you reaching out to Rachel, but you have an incredible story, and you should obviously continue to tell it and share it, and hopefully we can do that as well here on Pace Per Mile, and keep tracking you as you continue to cross the finish line together. So our hats go off to the two of you. Congratulations.
Thank you.
And Rachel, people can read about your story, about what you have done in the past, and obviously I'm hoping that you'll be able to get a chance to put a blog post up about the Ironman Texas. Where can people find out about your blog and read all about you?
Team Light Up the Darkness, that blogspot. I also have it underneath my Twitter handle, @UsherTheAthlete. I put stuff on there to talk about my adventure as a visually impaired athlete, as well as my adventure as a visually impaired person and mother, and all the hats that I wear and do on a daily basis.
And Carolyn, you're on Twitter as well, right?
I'm on Twitter, and my website is also, my blog is the same as my Twitter handle, which is Carolyn Bikes, CarolynBikes.
All right, fantastic. We will connect with the two of you in the future, all right?
Thank you. Looking forward to it.
At Pace Per Mile, we want to share your story. Do you know someone that has a compelling topic to share with the listeners? Help us tell your story or their story by emailing us today. info@pacepermile.com. That's info@pacepermile.com.